Hi friends, in this video we are going to discuss about the basic chest x-ray interpretation. So this is very important topic for any medical student. So before going into things proper, let us discuss some basic things what we must do on looking into a chest x-ray. So first thing is the basic things what we must do on taking an x-ray to the hand. So these, the coming 3 points are the technical aspects. They doesn't need any medical knowledge. These 3 are the technical aspects. Number 1, does the given x-ray belong to the correct patient? So please check the name of the patient on the x-ray and confirm that it belongs to the correct patient. So this belongs to the correct patient. Number 2, have the left and right side markers been labeled correctly? So if you see the chest x-ray film, you will be seeing some letters like L stands for left, and R which stands for right. So the side is usually marked before taking the chest x-ray. So this marking of left and right side is very important in assessing the cardiac, like dextrocardia. So to know the real dextrocardia, we must know whether it is the left side or the right side. So this is usually labeled by the personnel who is taking the x-ray. The third thing is, has the projection of the chest x-ray like PA film or AP film labeled on the chest x-ray? Sometimes you will also find these letters like PA view, AP view. What is this PA and AP view? We will be learning more technically, more medically in the next coming slides. So these are the 3 technical issues we must note before taking the chest x-ray or before analyzing the x-ray chest. Okay, the next thing, criteria for a good x-ray of the chest. So the coming 8 or 9 points says about the criteria of a good x-ray of a chest. Number 1, so if you look into the chest x-ray, the sternoclavicular junction or the sternoclavicular joint, it must be equidistant from the midline. See, the midline is usually taken like the sternum, the mid portion of the sternum is taken as the midline. So the junction, that is the sternoclavicular junction, should be equidistant from the midline. So if you check this in an x-ray, so this is where the midline, the spinous processes are, the mid part of the sternum is considered to be the midline, then the sternoclavicular junctions should be equally placed. The distance between this is equal on both the sides. So that is, sternoclavicular junction must be equidistant. This is the first point. The second point is, the mediastinum should be 2/3 to the left and 1/3 to the right. So let us check this in an x-ray chest. So see, this is the normal chest x-ray of a patient, a PA film which is taken. So if you see here, this is the mediastinum. This mediastinum, if you take, 2/3 of the mediastinum is to the left and 1/3 of the mediastinum is to the right, which states that it is a normal and a good x-ray projection. Number 3, lung apices must appear on the chest x-ray film. If you see in this chest x-ray, the lung apices, so this is the lung apex, so this should be visible on the chest x-ray. If this lung apices are to be visible while taking the x-ray technician should order the patient to take in a deep breath and hold like that. So once the patient or the subject takes a deep breath and hold like that, then the lung apices are filled with air which can be exposed on the chest x-ray film. So this apices of the lung should be visible, then only this will be a good chest x-ray, a good quality of chest x-ray. The fourth point, lower 3 cervical vertebra, that is C5, C6, C7, the lower 3 cervical vertebra should be visible on the chest x-ray. If you see in this film, these are the 3 lower cervical vertebra which are visible, visible on the chest x-ray. The fifth point is, the diaphragm should be found at the level of 8th to 10th posterior rib or 5th to 6th anterior rib. So from the anatomy aspect, every one of us know that the lung will be extending up to the sixth intercostal space or below the sixth rib in the anterior plane, up to the eighth rib or below the eighth rib in the lateral plane, and in the posterior plane it extends up to the 10th rib. So once the lung ends, then comes the diaphragm. So in the same way, a normal patient, the diaphragm should start at the level of 6th intercostal space anteriorly, at the level of 10th intercostal space posteriorly. So the diaphragm should be found at the level of 8th to 10th intercostal space in or 8th to 10th posterior rib or 5th to 6th anterior rib. So this is the fifth point for a good criteria or a good X-ray chest. The next thing, both the costophrenic and cardiophrenic angles must be visible on an X-ray chest. So if you go back and see, this is the costophrenic angle, the angle between the costo, that means the ribs, phrenic, that is the diaphragm. So the angle between the rib cage and the diaphragm, it is considered as the costophrenic angle. So this is the costophrenic angle on the right side, this is the costophrenic angle on the left side. Cardiophrenic angle, so the junction or the angle between the heart border and the diaphragm, this is called cardiophrenic angle, which should be visible. So both the sides, the costophrenic and the cardiophrenic angles must be visible. The next thing, scapula must be seen away from the lung fields. So the scapula, they should be seen away from the lung fields in a PA film, in a posterior anterior film. The differences between PA and AP we will be discussing in the further slides. Vertebral bodies should be barely visible through the heart, a very very important statement. If you see in the midline, there are the vertebral bodies. These vertebral bodies should be barely visible from the heart border. If they are more visible, it seems like it is overexposure. If they are not visible, it is underexposure. So the vertebral bodies must be barely visible through the heart. The last point is, intervertebral disc spaces and anterior ends of the ribs should not be found through the cardiac shadow. So the intervertebral disc spaces and the anterior end of the ribs must not be visible through the cardiac shadow. If they are visible, it implies that there is a overexposure of the film. So these are the 9 points to say that it is a good chest X-ray, or the criteria of a good chest X-ray are these 9 points. Now look into the normal chest X-ray. So now if you can see here, all the normal things are being met here, like coming from 1 to 9, every point is being seen here. Like the mediastinum is 2/3 to the left, 1/3 to the right, the lower 3 cervical vertebrae are visible, the lung apices are visible here, costophrenic and cardiophrenic angles are visible, and the diaphragm, if you count here, the posterior ribs 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9 and 10th. So at the 10th posterior rib, the diaphragm is starting. If you count the anterior ribs, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, it is starting at the 6th anterior rib, which is meeting the exact criteria. The scapula borders are visible away from the lung fields. The scapula borders are visible away from the lung fields. So every point of a normal good chest X-ray are being met in this chest X-ray. This is the lateral film, which is showing the vertebral column here, the cardiac shadow here, the sternum over the anterior portion, and this is the soft tissue shadow, the breast shadow, which is visible here. So this is the normal chest X-rays. This is the PA film and this is the lateral film. Now, a centrally positioned film, already we described the first point of a good criteria of X-ray. This the sternoclavicular junctions must be equidistant from the midline, that is the vertebral spinous processes. So this is a normal and a centrally positioned film. If you see here, these are the vertebral processes, these are the sternoclavicular junctions or joints which are equidistant on either side. So a rotated film, for example, say if the patient, when we are projecting an X-ray beam onto the patient must stand straight, and he should be standing straight. For example, if the patient has rotated like this, somehow a rotation has happened like this. So this rotation will bring the left sided sternoclavicular junction towards the midline and right sided sternoclavicular junction away from the midline. If you see, if you project the x-ray on that patient, what happens is the left sided joint distance between the center and the sternoclavicular junction will be less, whereas on the right side it is more. So this appears like a rotated film. So you see here, this is the central sternal border, sorry, this is central vertebral board, vertebral spinous processes. See, the right side, the junction, the distance between the junction and the center is very high, whereas on the left side it is very less. So it implies that there is a rotation. So in a rotated film, when you are assessing, everything will be abnormal. So see to that, the position of the patient is normal and the good x-ray only you should interpret. If you interpret in this film now, what happens is, because of this tilt of the patient, the cardiac shadow will appear like as if there is a cardiac enlargement. Or sometimes the left is coming anteriorly, the right posteriorly, and right is going anteriorly. So whatever the things that are present on the right side, like right hilar structures, may not be visible because of this cardiac shadow overweening that. So sometimes it is difficult for us to interpret when you are interpreting a rotated films. So right hilar structures may not be visible, or heart shadow may appear like as if there is a cardiomegaly, an apparent cardiomegaly may be there. So central positioning of the patient is a must and should thing which should be done for any chest x-ray. Okay. The next thing is about the exposure. Already while discussing about the good exposure criteria or good x-ray criteria, I have said the sternal borders, through the cardiac shadow, you must be barely seeing the vertebral bodies, and intervertebral disc spaces and the anterior ends of the ribs must not be visible through the cardiac shadow. So based on that, you are dividing this penetration into or exposure into overexposure and underexposure. So these are the two x-ray films. The left one shows a underexposed film, the right one shows a overexposed film. So if you see clearly in these images, the underexposed film, you are not at all able to see any vertebral body in the center. Yes? Whereas on the opposite side, if you see, the vertebral bodies are clearly seen, they are clearly seen throughout the chest x-ray. The lung shadows or the lung fields, they are like whitish on underexposed film and they are very dark on the overexposure film. So there are no vascular markings visible in a overexposed film. Whereas in underexposed film, more vascular markings are visible on this x-ray. The next thing is intervertebral disc spaces are not at all seen. The anterior ends of ribs are not at all seen. Whereas here, if you are clearly seeing through this cardiac shadow, the intervertebral disc space is seen here. Yes, one. This is another intervertebral disc space. This is another intervertebral disc space, which is easily visible through this x-ray film. So the differences are, underexposed film, also called as soft film, the vertebral bodies are not visible and intervertebral disc spaces are not seen through the cardiac shadow. Whereas overexposed film, also called as a hard film, where the vertebral bodies are clearly visible and intervertebral disc spaces are clearly seen through the cardiac shadow. So these are the differences between underexposure and overexposed film. The next most important thing for any student, the differences between a AP view and a PA view. So AP stands for anterior posterior view. PA stands for posterior anterior view. See, AP, anterior posterior. So it implies that the X-ray beam is being projected from anterior to posterior. So the X-ray beam is being projected from the anterior portion of the body and it is going to the posterior portion of the chest. Whereas PA film, the X-ray beam is projected from the posterior point, it is coming to the anterior portion. So based on where this projection is happening, projection of X-rays is happening, it is divided into PA and AP. If you see in these images, PA film, the X-ray beam is projected from posteriorly. AP film, the X-ray beam is projected from anteriorly. The second thing is positioning of the patient. See, in an AP film, The patient will be positioned like he is standing still like this and exposing the chest, making his shoulders go away from each other and the scapula are coming nearer to each other. So the patient is asked to expose his film or expose his chest like this. So the scapula, the inner borders of scapula are coming nearer to each other in the midline, and the shoulder joints or the acromioclavicular junction joints are going away from each other and they are going upwards. Yes. Whereas if you see in a PA film or PA view, the patient is asked to take the arms away from each other like this, so that the scapular borders are moving away from each other. Inner borders of scapula are moving away from each other, and he is asked to take the make the arms away from each other and project it anteriorly like this. So the inner borders of scapula are going away from each other. So the differences between AP view and PA view are, number one, the clavicles. The clavicles are seen above the lung fields, above the apex of the lung fields. See in this film, so already I discussed, the patient is asked to do like this. So the clavicles are going upwards and they are going away from each other. Whereas the scapula are coming inwards and nearer to each other. So these clavicles are projected in this way, or it is like it is going in this way, upwards and outwards. So the acromioclavicular junction, acromioclavicular joint will be high from the apex of the lung. It is more height, or it is going away, height higher than the apex of the lung fields. The clavicles are going in this way, like going up or going higher than the lung apices. See here, these are the lung apices, whereas the acromioclavicular joint is here, and the clavicles are appear as if they are obliquely arranged and going almost they are oblique or almost they are straight going upwards. Whereas if you see a PA film, so the patient is asked to do in this way, like he is asking to do in this way. The clavicles are becoming almost straight. They are like transverse, they are like straight, and they are in the line of the apex of the lung field or below the apex of the lung field. The acromioclavicular junction will be in line with the apex of the lung, or it is below the apex of the lung. So you got my point here. So the AP film, the patient's position is doing in this way. So that is why the clavicles are moving, or clavicles are positioned like vertically positioned. Whereas in PA film, they are transversely positioned, number one. Number two, the scapula. The inner borders of scapula are coming nearer to each other in AP film, and they are appearing on the lung fields. See, the inner border of scapula is here on this film, and this is the inner border of scapula on the left side, which are appearing on the lung fields only. They are appearing on the lung fields. Whereas if you see in a PA film, the patient is doing in this way, the inner borders of scapula are moving away from each other, they are going away from the lung fields, they are going away from the lung fields. See, in this film, the inner border of scapula is almost away from the lung fields, that is there in the soft tissue here. Here also it is there in the soft tissue, away from the ribcage. Okay. The third point is ribs. As the projection in AP view is coming from anteriorly, the anterior ribs are more visible or clearly visible in patient in AP view. Whereas it is coming from posteriorly, so posterior ribs in PA view, posterior ribs are clearly visible in PA view. So these are the posterior ribs. Here also there are posterior ribs, but anterior ribs are clearly more visible here when compared to posterior ribs. Then cardiomegaly. So in spite there is no cardiomegaly, clear cardiomegaly, in projection of AP, there is an apparent cardiomegaly. There is no real cardiomegaly. Apparent cardiomegaly is a feature of AP view. So these are the four basic differences between AP film and a PA film. So on taking an X-ray, you must be able to identify whether it is a PA or an AP film. So now, having learned some important criteria about the exposure, about the penetration and all, the next thing is, let us see into the normal radiological anatomy. What are the different structures that are visible in a chest X-ray? See, when someone gives you a chest X-ray, it is not only to comment on the lungs. It is not only to comment on the heart. There are many things which we are finding or which you can be able to see in an X-ray of a chest. So starting from skin, going inside the heart, there are many structures which are visible on the chest X-ray. So what are the different structures we need to comment, we need to see in a chest x-ray? So first we need to start with the soft tissues and the skin. Some cases like a traumatic patient who has underwent a road traffic accident, that patient might have got a surgical emphysema, like the air has entered into his subcutaneous tissue causing a surgical emphysema. So this will be easily visible on a chest x-ray, like air or black shadow in the soft tissue, which is visible as surgical emphysema, which is called as surgical emphysema. Or sometimes some patients will have an abscess in the chest, abscess in the skin, which is extending into the soft tissue. This may be visible on the chest x-ray. So don't forget to look into the skin and soft tissues. Don't jump directly into the lungs or into the heart. So first see the skin and the soft tissue. After seeing that, then look into the rib cage or the bony structures. So there are different bony structures that are present. Like there are ribs, anterior ribs and posterior ribs. There is sternum, sternoclavicular junctions. There is clavicles. There are acromioclavicular joints. Scapula are there. So see to that whether there is any abnormality in these bony tissues. This is the second thing. The third thing is look into the trachea. So what is happening to the trachea? Is it in the center? Is it deviated to the right or is it deviated to the left? What happened to the tracheal bifurcation? Is it bifurcating at the normal plane or it is going down or it is high up? Then after that, look into the lung tissues. So how to look into the lung tissue, how to make it into different zones and all, I will be explaining to you. Then go into the cardiac tissue. So what happened to the cardiac tissue? Then look at the diaphragms. Look at the CP angles, that is costophrenic and cardiophrenic angles. So you need to analyze this in a systematic way. How to analyze this in a systematic way, I will be explaining to you. Before going into that, what are the normal borders? What are the normal radiological structures that are seen on the right and left of the or in the chest x-ray, we will be discussing now. If we look into this normal chest x-ray, these are the different things which you are able to see. I said that skin and soft tissue is the first thing. So this white color or the whitish thing which is appearing, all the thing which is appearing away from the ribcage is the soft tissue here, skin and the soft tissue here, on the right it is the skin and soft tissue here. The trachea which is centrally positioned here, this is the trachea. These are the vertebral bodies and the spinous processes. Then comes this lung which is divided into upper lobe, mid lobe and lower lobe on the right, upper lobe and lower lobe on the left. These are the fissures which are dividing the lung into lobes, like horizontal fissure, right horizontal fissure, oblique fissure. This is the oblique fissure. Then the cardiac borders on the right, they are formed by superior vena cava, the right atrium. Then it is merging into inferior vena cava. Sometimes inferior vena cava may be visible and sometimes it may not be visible. And the diaphragmatic shadow is this. That is. This is the costophrenic angle. On the left side, the border of right heart is formed by the aortic arch, followed by the pulmonary bay. This is the pulmonary bay, the left atrium and the left ventricle. So merging into the diaphragm, so this is the costophrenic angle. The junction or the angle between the diaphragm and the heart is called as cardiophrenic angle, which is seen on both sides. So going down the diaphragm, we can see a stomach bubble. So this is the stomach shadow which is seen as a stomach bubble. So these are the different structures which we are able to see in patient in a normal chest x-ray. These are the normal radiological things which we are able to identify on a chest x-ray. Next, in order to comment on the lung fields, you need to, as we know, there are three lobes on right and two lobes on the left lung. So we are not on radiological interpretation, we are not going to use these terms called lobes. For radiological interpretation purpose, we are dividing the lungs into three equal zones on both the sides: upper zone, mid zone and the lower zone. So any abnormality in the lung should be commented only with the help of these zones. So upper zone, if some abnormality is seen in the upper part, so then you need to say this abnormality is present in the upper zone on the right side, or if it is present on the lower zone on the left side, you need to use the terms called zones. So how these zones are divided? So the upper zone is whatever the lung tissue that is present behind the first and second ribs. So which ribs? It is the anterior ribs. So whatever the tissue of lung that is present, this is the first anterior rib, this is the second anterior rib. So whatever the lung tissue that is present behind the first and second is upper zone. Third and fourth, middle zone. Fifth and sixth, lower zone. Okay, anything below that is lower zone. So this is how we divide the X-ray into three equal zones. So this pathology should be commented based on the zones. Then how to comment these pathologies? See, for example, if you see some chest X-rays, you are able to find some black shadows, some white shadows, or it can be like somewhere between black and white. There are different shadows that are being visible on the chest X-ray. So you need to interpret these shadows based on their densities and analyze whether it is a consolidation or whether it is a pleural effusion or whether it is a mass or whether it is an infective focus or some other thing. So for that, basic thing is to understand the densities on the chest X-ray. See, when you looked into the normal chest X-ray previously, so you are finding heart as white, yes, the lungs are black, the soft tissue is white, the bones are more brighter. So this depends upon the density of the tissue. In the same way, if some pathology is there, like a liquid is there in the lung, what is the liquid in the lung? Pleural effusion. Already the heart has got a liquid in it, that is the blood. So whatever the tissue, whatever the shadow or the density that is there for the heart, the same density will be there for this liquid also. So if there is a liquid accumulation inside the lung, then the density of that will be like that of the heart. So a whitish density is similar to that of the heart, filling the costophrenic angle. So this is a diagnosis of pleural effusion. Or see, if there is some other tissue like a soft tissue like density which is seen in mid zone of right lung, that signifies a soft tissue like density, an active infective focus, it may be a consolidation, it may be a concern. So for that you need to understand the different densities here. See, if you see a chest X-ray, there are many densities that are visible, like the air will be more black in color. So which is there? Where is the air present in the chest X-ray? It is there on the lungs. So all the lungs will appear like a black color lungs. On the chest X-ray, you will be seeing some projections like things, small projection like things, which are nothing but the vasculature. So what is there inside the vasculature? Blood. So blood inside the vasculature, if you put a chest X-ray beam over that blood, it appears like white. So that is why on a chest X-ray, you will be seeing many tree branch like structures which are the vascular markings. Then fat or the soft tissue, that is usually intermediate between white and black, a density similar to this color will be there. Water or the blood, it will have the density like that of heart. Bone, which is more denser than the heart density. So these are the four different densities. So air density, fat density or soft tissue density, cardiac density or heart density or blood density. Fourth one is the bone density. So whenever you are explaining a lesion in the chest X-ray, you need to explain in this way. Here is a chest X-ray of a patient which is so showing a blood density lesion or a bone density lesion or an air dense lesion seen in the upper zone or in the lower zone of which side, right side or left side. Then is what is the extent of that lesion, what is the size of that lesion. See, for example, sir, here is a 5 × 6 mm rounded opacity which is of bone dense lesion which is seen on the right upper zone, suggestive of a calcification. Yes, so in that way you need to explain the radiological terms. So this is how to explain a chest X-ray. So we'll be going to deal about this still further. Then what are the different things we need to look? Already I have given you like what are the different things we need to look. So these are the different things we need to see, like the soft tissues and the skin, the bony thoracic cage, the pleura, the diaphragms, the lungs, the mediastinum and the heart. So these are the different things. So let us highlight some important points under different headings. First is the soft tissues, skin and the bony skeleton. what are the important things? We are not going to discuss every detail. What are the important things for a student now? So the ribs, how to classify the anterior and posterior ribs, or how to look into the anterior and posterior ribs, is the common thing which the students find very difficult. See, this is an image showing the anterior and posterior ribs. So the posterior ribs are almost transversely arranged. The anterior ribs are like obliquely arranged. So in a PA film, so whatever we are seeing straight away, if you look into the chest x-ray, whatever the thing you are finding are the posterior views, are the posterior ribs. So anterior ribs must be, they are obliquely placed. See, this is how to trace posterior and anterior ribs. So these are the posterior ribs, which are clearly visible. Anterior ribs are traced from anteriorly to posteriorly like this. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So the students find often difficult to trace anterior and posterior ribs. So this image gives you a good clarity or good explanation about the anterior and the posterior ribs, tracing of anterior and posterior. Other things what we need to look is the clavicles. The clavicles are almost horizontal in PA film, whereas they are vertically placed in AP film. Vertebral bodies, already we discussed much about this. The vertebral bodies, the intervertebral disc spaces, they are barely visible in a normal chest x-ray. The shoulder joints, the acromioclavicular joints, which are high up in AP film and the same level of lung apices in the PA film. So then you need to look into the asymmetry in between the right and the left side. Any asymmetry between right and left is pathological. Yes. Then is the pleura and the diaphragm. The important things here is, the diaphragms, how they are positioned. Normally, if you see, the liver is there on the right side, yes? This liver on the right side usually pushes the diaphragm somewhat high on the right when compared to the left. In a normal individual, the right diaphragm is somewhat higher than the left diaphragm. So, how much high it should be there? Not if it is there like right diaphragm at the 4th intercostal space and left diaphragm at 7th intercostal space, it is not normal. Yes? So normally the gap or the difference between right and left, the highest point of right diaphragm is usually 1 to 1.5 centimeters higher than the left. A very, very important thing. So if you are finding a gap of more than 1.5 centimeter, it is pathological. It is abnormal. So see, the highest point of the right diaphragm is almost 1 to 1.5 centimeter higher than the left one. Okay. Each costophrenic angle must be sharply visible. If there is any abnormality like not visible costophrenic angle, suggests a minimal pleural effusion. So the first point or the first thing that happens in a patient with pleural effusion is blunting of the costophrenic angles. So normally the highest point of the right diaphragm is 1 to 1.5 centimeter. The next point we must note is about the diaphragmatic doming and diaphragmatic flattening. See, in some patients like COPD individuals where there are hyperinflated lung fields, this hyperinflated lung fields is in fact pushing the diaphragm downwards, making it become flat. Okay. Some patients who have got an intra-abdominal pathology, they are pushing or they are giving a pressure effect from down to up, making the diaphragm to go into a domed shape. So what is this doming? What is this flattening? So in order to assess this doming or flattening, we need to make or we need to draw two lines on the chest x-ray film. So what are those lines? The first line is, this line should be drawn tangentially at the highest point of the diaphragm. See, if this is the diaphragm, this is the highest point of the diaphragm. We are drawing a diagonally or tangential line which is just meeting the highest portion of the diaphragm. The second line is, this line should be drawn from the costophrenic angle to the cardiophrenic angle. So, got my point here? The costophrenic angle to the cardiophrenic angle. So now compare these two lines, measure the distance between these two lines. So if this distance is less than 1.5 centimeter, it is, so normally this distance is 1 to 1.5 centimeter. If this distance is more than 1.5 centimeter, it signifies that the diaphragm has domed upwards. Yes? If this distance is less than 1 centimeter, it means that the diaphragm is flattened down like this. So, the two lines we mean to draw, one is tangential line at the highest portion or the highest portion of diaphragm. The second is between two costophrenic and cardiophrenic angles. So, the distance between these two lines should be measured. If it is more than 1.5, it is doming of diaphragm. If it is less than 1 centimeter, it is flattening of diaphragm. Okay. This is about assessment of diaphragmatic flattening or doming. The next thing is the hilar regions. So, if you see the chest x-ray, this hilum on the right and hilum on the left. So, usually the left hilar border, the left hilum will be somewhat higher than the right hilum. So, this gap or difference between left and right hilum is usually less than 1 centimeter. This is the left hilum, this is the right hilum. So, this left hilum is 1 centimeter above that of the right hilum. Both the hyla should have equal density and they should be concave. A very, very, very important statement. Concave hyla is seen in a normal x-ray. For some reason, if there is a lymph node enlargement here, then this concavity is filled up by this lymph node enlargement, making this hyla become convex. Okay. So, concave hyla like this, if there is a lymphadenopathy here, this becomes a convex. So, convexity of hilum is abnormal. Concavity of hilar regions are normal. So, the most important thing that happens in hyla is the lymphadenopathy, which is seen in many diseases, like the most common disease being the tuberculosis, or it can also happen because of this bronchogenic carcinomas also. Okay, so concavity of hilum, so see to that concavity is present, it implies that it is abnormal. So always it should be, sorry, convexity is present, it is abnormal. Concavity is normal. The next thing is assessment of cardiomegaly. Assessment of cardiomegaly. So how to say based on a chest x-ray, the cardiomegaly or the heart is enlarged or not. See, normally we discussed in the previous slides, like AP film will have an apparent cardiomegaly. So, the best film to assess real cardiomegaly is always the PA view. It is always the posterior anterior view. So, in posterior anterior view, how to assess this? So, how to assess this is very important. See, now here, we need to draw. The first thing is, we need to draw a midline like this. So, which is just going through the spinous processes. From the midline, you need to take two points. So, the highest point or the largest point from the midline on either sides of the heart should be taken. See here, this is the highest portion or this is the lateralmost portion. From here, draw one line which is connecting the midline. Here, this is the latermost portion where you are drawing another line. So, measure the first distance and the second distance. Say if it is x. So, we have calculated the first and the second one. Say it is x. Then, take the highest distance or the longest distance between two cardiofren, the longest diameter of the thorax. Usually, it is seen at the costophrenic angles. So, take this diameter. So, the first length by this longest diameter, if it is less than half, that is 50%, it is normal. If it is more than 50%, it is abnormal, that it is, there is a cardiomegaly. So, this is the best way to see whether the cardiomegaly is present or not. So, the first distance is on both sides. Take the longest diameter or the longest length of the heart available. So, calculate or add these two. This gives one value. Say for example, if it is 15. Take the longest diameter of the thorax. So, if it is 35, 15 by 35, it is less than 50%. So, it is a normal. So, if first one is 15, the second one is 20 or 25, it implies more than 50%. So, it is abnormal. So, cardiomegaly is calculated in this way. Then the last thing is, don't forget to look into the hidden areas. There are some areas which are not visible in a normal chest x-ray. In a normal chest x-ray PA view, in a normal AP projection. So these hidden areas are whatever the thing that is present behind the clavicles, the lung apices that are present behind the clavicles, the things that are present behind the heart, the mediastinal, posterior mediastinal structures, the things that are present behind the diaphragms. So these are the hidden areas. So in order to enlighten or highlight these hidden areas, you need to go for other views like oblique views or the lateral views. Okay. So this is some important things what we must know before analyzing the chest x-ray or before making a diagnosis based on a chest x-ray. Now let us take an example and describe an x-ray. So this is how the purpose of taking this class is to describe this x-ray now. See, for example, now say some x-ray is given to you in your hand. So now you need to systematically analyze this x-ray in radiological terms, not in the terms what we know. Like giving an x-ray to you, don't obviously jump into the diagnosis and say that it is a consolidation, or obviously don't say that there is a cardiomegaly, or don't say that there is a pleural effusion. So when someone gives you a chest x-ray, so you need to find two important things: where is the lesion and what is the lesion. So for that you need to systematically go step by step and analyze everything. First analyze the technical things, whether the name, whether the AP film, AP PA views or L and R are written on the x-ray film. Then analyze whether it is centrally positioned. Then analyze whether this is having good exposure. Then analyze whether the criteria for good x-ray are met or not. Only after analyzing this, then you need to look into the lesion. So if someone gives you an underexposed film, or someone gives you a film which is having a rotation, so don't read that x-ray, or don't jump into a diagnosis from that x-ray. Yes. So once all the good criteria of a good x-ray are met, then you need to systematically analyze. Number one, the soft tissues. Number two, the skin, the vertebral columns, the bony tissues. Number three, the trachea. Number four, the lung fields in the form of zones. Yes. Number five, the costophrenic and cardiophrenic angles. Number six, the diaphragm. Number seven, the mediastinum and the heart. So analyze in these ways, then you will find some lesion there. So you know all the normal things now. So if some abnormality is present, like some lesion is there in the mid zone on the right side. So mid zone, there is a lesion on the right side. So that is, where is the lesion? Then what is the lesion? Already we described the densities of different things. So you need to say what is the lesion, what are the things you need to answer? What is the size of the lesion? What is the density of the lesion? What are the borders of that lesion? What is the extent of that lesion? Where it is extending, whether it is extending into upper zone, mid zone, lower zone, or it is pan, which is present everywhere in the right lung. Okay. So what is the lesion and where is the lesion completes your diagnosis. So for where is the lesion, you need to answer these three questions. Number one, what is the tissue that is involved? In which tissue this is present? Whether it is present in the soft tissue, whether it is present in the bone, lung or the heart. The second thing is, on which side it is present? Is it on the right or is it on the left? Third thing is, in which zone it is present? It is very simple. Like, see, for lung pathology, for example, a consolidation is there. So you need to say, a lesion is present in the right mid zone of the lung. So the zone is over, the side is over, the tissue is over. So mention the tissue, the zone and the side. These are the three things to say under where is lesion. Then the next question is, what is the lesion? What is the lesion? You need to answer these seven questions. Number one, what is the size of the lesion? Is it 2 into 3 centimeter, 4 into 5 centimeter? So what is the size of the lesion? Number two, how many lesions are present? Is it a solitary lesion or a multiple lesion, or multiple lesions which are patched up and becoming a single solitary lesion, or this is a matted thing like lesion? So you need to say number of lesions. The third thing is, what is the shape of the lesion? A wedge shaped peripheral opacity is seen on the periphery of the lung, suggestive of an infarct. Yes. So wedge shape itself gives you a diagnosis, it is an infarct. Yes. What is the edge of the lesion, whether it is smooth edged or irregular? The fifth one is, what is the pattern of the lesion? Whether it is nodular, nodules like thing, reticular, straight line thing. So reticular shadows suggestive of old fibrotic lesions seen in pulmonary tuberculosis. Nodular opacities which are fluffy suggestive of reactivation of tuberculosis. See, simple explanation or simple seeing of this pattern of the lesion gives you an idea on the diagnosis. Reticular lesions, shadows, reticular shadows, which are more white in density. So, suggestive of old calcified lesions, which is because of old pulmonary tuberculosis. In nodular fluffy opacities, which are whitish in color like that of the blood or like that of the heart shadow, signifies a reactivation of pulmonary tuberculosis. So, that is about the pattern of lesion. Density, we all know. Air dense, bone dense, or it is soft tissue dense, or it is heart dense. Okay. Then, distribution, whether it is focal, confined only to one lung, or widespread. For example, in miliary tuberculosis, it is widespread, seen on both the lungs, everywhere inside the lung. So, miliary tuberculosis. So, whether it is focal or widespread. So, if you are able to answer these 3 and 7, that is 10 questions, you are able to master a chest X-ray now. So, now let us do this with the help of an example. So, here is a chest X-ray given to you. So, analyze this chest X-ray, this is what is asked. If you see here, all the technical things, leave about the technical things, then all the criteria for good X-ray, whether they are met or not. So, this is almost a centrally positioned film, correct? The vertebral bodies are visible here, yes. The soft tissues are delineated here. The clavicles are seen, the ribs are seen, the soft tissues are seen, everything is okay. Now, let us analyze in a systematic way. First, skin and the soft tissues. So, if you see here in the soft tissue, there is no obvious air dense lesions or obvious water dense or bone dense lesions. So, the soft tissue density is normal here. On the other side also, soft tissue density is normal. So, there is no pathology in the soft tissue. Then, go to the ribs, go to the bony structures. This scapula is seen here, which is normal. Scapula is seen on this side, which is normal. Clavicles are seen up to the extent whatever we are seeing. The clavicles are normal. The vertebral bodies are normal. The ribs, these are the posterior ribs. Almost there is no fractures or no break of these ribs. So, the bony structures appears to be normal. The next thing, trachea. If you see this trachea, it is centrally positioned and coming down, it is bifurcated into right main bronchus and the left main bronchus here. So, it is almost normal again. Then, going to the lung fields. So, now divide this lung into upper zone. So, up to here it is the upper zone. So, here up to here it is the upper zone. Then, the third and fourth up to here it is the mid zone. The down one is the lower zone. Okay. So, first and second ribs it is the upper zone. Third and fourth ribs, it is the lower zone. Below that is the mid zone. Below that is the lower zone. Now, if you see, upper zone, it is normal. Mid zone, there is some abnormality. Lower zone, it is almost normal. Whereas on the left side, everything is normal. Like normal lung tissue, lung shadow with vascular markings is seen. Okay, what is this abnormality? We need to explain now. What is the size of this lesion? Where it is seen? What is the extent of this lesion? What is the border of this lesion? What is the density of this lesion? Everything we need to explain now. Yes? So, now let us wait for a minute and go and see other things like costophrenic and cardiophrenic angles, which are obviously normal, right? Here the costophrenic and cardiophrenic angles are normal. The cardiac shadow, it appears to be normal. There is no abnormality, like it is less than 50%. The diaphragms are normal. There is no flattening or no doming of diaphragm. If you want, you can draw two lines and see the distance here. So, they appears to be normal. So, now our purpose is to explain this lesion now. So, how to explain this lesion? So, where is the lesion? 1, 2, 3. It is there on the right side, in the mid zone, in the lung. These are the three questions. So, it is there on the right middle zone of the lung. What is the lesion? So, what is the size of the lesion? It is almost 7 into 5 centimeter lesion, a single solitary lesion which is wedge shaped, or it is almost a rectangular shaped lesion is there. So, which is having an irregular edge, and the pattern of the lesion here, which is very important, it has got an air bronchogram pattern which is signifying or suggestive of consolidation. So air bronchogram pattern, which is typical of consolidation. So what is this air bronchogram pattern? I will be explaining to you in the next video, that is on X-ray of some important diseases. Then the density of this lesion is water dense lesion, which is suggestive of again a consolidation with the so the distribution is focal distribution confined only to the right mid zone. So now here is a solitary water dense lesion of size approximately 7 into 5 cm, a wedge or rectangular shaped lesion with air bronchogram pattern on the right mid zone of the lung, probably a consolidation because of a pneumonia. So this is how we need to explain or give present an X-ray to the examiner or to the person who is asking you. Okay, so these are the different things you need to X-ray, you need to find, you need to explain in a chest X-ray. So with this we will be ending this session. In the next video we are going to discuss about chest X-rays in some important respiratory and cardiac conditions. So thank you. So for next video, for more videos, you can subscribe to our channel Conceptual Medicine by Dr. Prathap Bingi. Thank you.